Thanks for coming. I'm going to talk about building and deploying GPU applications in the cloud. Just a quick bit of background about who I am, because I'm probably not from the typical type of industry that you're dealing with. My background is computer science. I originally started a company that did photorealistic rendering as a service, not the software development side of it, but the actual creation of 3D models and so forth. So the actual rendering services company, so basically artistic production and so forth. I've lectured in computer graphics and previously worked at NVIDIA and a company called Metal Images that was bought by NVIDIA that was focused on producing rendering software. The product at the time was called Mental Ray, which you might have heard of. It's been used on a lot of feature films and those sort of things. But my responsibility was actually the reality server product, which is what we've taken over at migenius, which is a company I've since founded after leaving NVIDIA. So just a little bit about what migenius actually do. We started in about 2010, so I've been around for nearly 6 years now. Offices in Melbourne, London, and Tokyo. We do a lot of business in the US, but we don't actually have a physical office here. It's obviously one of the advantages of doing this type of cloud business is we don't have to necessarily be physically everywhere we're doing business. Our background traditionally is actually from the lighting industry and architectural and construction industry. So a lot of the projects that we've worked on have been for architectural visualization or managing of building data, those sort of things. We're doing a lot of work in other areas now, but this is where we've come from. And it's one of the reasons that we focus on accuracy in our renderings, physical correctness, and so forth. We took over Reality Server from NVIDIA when they stopped developing it. They decided to focus on some of the other technologies that they were building, and we felt that Reality Server still had some potential, so we decided to take that over and continue its development, and we've been working on it ever since. We work with a lot of larger enterprise customers, and that was the traditional customer of Reality Server, but we've since moved on to focus a little bit more on end-user products, including rendering tools that you can use in desktop applications and those sorts of things. In our past life, when we're dealing with the architectural construction industry, we dealt with a lot of very large-scale infrastructure projects, urban management, those sort of things. For example, Heathrow Terminal 5, projects like that. Very large building and construction projects. And these have forced us to work out ways to deal with very large data sets over time. With Reality Server actually came quite a few existing customers, but we've now built on that and we have quite a lot of customers using Reality Server, quite a few of them also using it on Nimbix. So we also offer Reality Server as a pre-wrapped service on Nimbix that you can go onto the website and pull that off. I didn't really mention, it was mentioned in the introduction, but obviously our focus is on photorealistic 3D rendering, so that's what the actual software is doing. Just a quick diversion to talk about our partner, NVIDIA. NVIDIA provide us the actual core rendering technology, so we don't implement the renderer ourselves. There's more than enough renderers in the world now. Nobody needs another renderer. So we decided instead of building our own, we'd license basically one of the best of breed renderers in the industry. And for us, that's the NVIDIA Iray product. There's quite a few images just scattered throughout this presentation. All the images have been rendered with Iray using our Reality Server platform. So everything you see, I think with one exception, is actually computer generated. Reality Server actually embeds the Iray renderer and wraps that up in a web service that you can access. Being an NVIDIA technology, it's obviously heavily optimized for GPUs already. So it's very fast on the GPU. Just what we're going to cover today, I'm going to talk a little bit about why you'd actually want to use GPUs in the cloud in the first place. It shouldn't be a foregone conclusion that you just start using these things because they're cool. There's got to be an actual commercial imperative for doing it. And I'm going to talk a little bit about what that was for us and, you know, why we do those things. I'm going to talk as well about how we've built some of the applications that we create for our customers in the cloud with GPUs, and that's more on the development side of things. I won't go into too much detail. It's pretty high level, But I'm also going to talk maybe in a little bit more detail than the building side, the deploying side, because that's where Nimbix comes in a lot more detail. I also want to just finish with a few statements about where I think this might be going and what we see needs to happen, especially in the areas that are relevant to people who are interested in Nimbix and cloud deployment and those sort of things. There's a few areas that we'd like to see, you know, a few directions we'd like to see this pushed in terms of making things available. So start with why do you actually want to use GPUs? I mean, it's obviously you hear a lot about it and there's a lot of things being done with them, but you might not necessarily know why you want to use them. Now, I suspect a lot of people here are already using them. How many people here are already actually using GPUs for computation? So probably a little less than half. I think it's not necessarily the case that you would use them unless your algorithm is well suited to it. So a lot of people, the obstacle has been sort of getting over that hump of getting your algorithm ported to GPU and so forth. But once you're there, I mean, there's only really one reason commercially to use GPU hardware, and that's because somehow it's going to be cheaper, faster, or better. Those are the only things that you're really looking for. And in our case, of course, it's definitely helping us on all those aspects. So this image that you see here to the right, this is rendered in our Bloom Unit product, which is based on Reality Server and using Nimbix on the back end. An image like this rendering on a standard CPU type server is probably going to take well over 2 hours to compute. On a GPU server, we're doing this in something more like 10 minutes. So that's a pretty immediate kind of gain. And the thing is that for a user, I mean, the difference between 2 hours and 10 minutes is dramatic. And the other thing is that not only is there a big difference in performance, there's also a big difference in interactivity. So the user can not only get the image back in 10 minutes, but they can get in seconds a less converged version of that image, so a lower quality version that they can make decisions with, so they can iterate very fast in the process. Now, this is just rendering I'm talking about. Obviously, there's lots of other applications that have similar order of magnitude increases in performance associated with GPUs. Now, it's not just about performance, it's also about price performance. And for us on the commercial side, that's obviously a huge part of it. And price performance, GPUs are also winning. And it doesn't take much to look at doing some benchmarks on, you know, what your typical data sets would be to work out that GPUs are typically, if your algorithm is optimized for it, GPUs come out well in front in terms of price performance. But what about the cloud? Well, it's obviously another thing that you're not necessarily using, or you don't necessarily, you know, assume that you should use. But in general, cloud computing, again, it has the same principles. You should only use it if it's somehow going to be better, faster, or cheaper. For us, this is very important because a lot of our customers need that flexibility in their deployments. They don't just want to have a few servers and then buy more servers when they need them. We're dealing with companies that might, for example, have resource requirements that are tied to marketing campaigns. So if they do an email blast out to somebody, they might have a period of 48 hours where they expect 4 or 5 times the amount of traffic that they were going to get before. It's going to generate load on their GPU resources. To manage that, they obviously don't want to manage for the peak and buy all that hardware or have it all reserved. They need to be able to expand in and out dynamically. And that's where the cloud can help them. And it might be that they're using a combination of, you know, the cloud resources and local resources, so they might have it all in the cloud. But either way, it gives them that flexibility. And if you're not doing that, then obviously you have static servers. You are simply going to fall over when you get that load come in. You don't have the option to scale it up. The other big reason, and it's kind of sits aside from the compute side of things, is that a lot of our customers are already dealing with things where they've got other aspects of their application in the cloud. So their business logic that's not necessarily compute heavy, certainly not from the perspective of the people in this room, that might be somewhere else sitting in the cloud. Typically, they don't have, these days, most companies we deal with do not have in-house databases and business logic and systems that are driving their websites and things, it's all sitting in the cloud. So it makes a lot of sense for them to deploy the other services they're using on the compute side in the cloud as well, so that they can talk to each other without having to come back into their own infrastructure and resources. So when you put these things together, what do you get? Well, what I'd like to show you is just a movie. It's a couple minutes long. It just shows a bit of a showreel of what some of our customers are doing using GPUs in the cloud together. And it'll give you a bit of a flavor for the types of things that migenius does and the types of things that our customers are doing. So what was all that? obviously, this is a lot of commercial, non-HPC applications that we're deploying. A little bit different to probably what a lot of people here have been looking at. There's probably even some websites some of you may have even used that didn't know that were generated images or that were generating images in the cloud. There's a lot of household names there, as you could see. Just to run through some of the types of applications that were represented in what you just saw, because it was quite a lot in a short amount of time. There are some things for home design and planning. We have several customers that do this type of thing with both browser-based and tablet-based applications where people can lay out their houses and see photorealistic renderings of those. There was a lot of configuration and for mass customization. So mass customization is basically an industry where you do custom products for customers. So you saw a lot of things like the custom jackets, shoes, these types of products, and they're manufactured basically just in time for the user. So the customer comes in and they order it. The problem is, of course, you need to show what the customer is going to get. And the number of combinations is essentially infinite. In many cases, it's well into the billions. So you have to be able to show them what they're going to get, but how do you do that? You can't pre-generate everything. It would take far too long. The only way to do it is to render the images in the cloud and to then deliver those images to the customer so they can see what it is that they're going to get. You also saw some rendering plugins for desktop applications like SketchUp, Revit, Maya, these sorts of things. And they're basically where you've got a desktop application, but it's connected to cloud resources that are doing the rendering. There was some urban planning and management We've been doing quite a bit of this in the lighting industry where people have been planning urban lighting scenarios so they can, for example, see the difference between different types of lighting scenarios. Product design for just-in-time manufacturing. You saw the one near the end, the Takamoto bottles. This is a company that produces custom-made-to-order bottles for cosmetics and similar products. And their customers design the bottle, and then they're manufactured on demand, basically. So they're not pre-made. Lighting design and analysis, online jewelry. There's many more that can be done, and there's quite a lot that has not been shown. That showreel is actually from last year. So there's quite a lot of customers that we've gotten in the last 6 months that aren't represented in there. So how do we go about building these types of applications for the cloud? What kind of things do we have to think about when we're creating these applications? Usually the GPU cloud is a bit of a black box to our customers. So what they're looking for usually is something where they just say, I want to call this service and I want to get an image back. And they would send a description, for example, if it's a jacket, they might send a description saying, you know, this is the color of the sleeves, this is the color of the zips, this is the color of this thing. Maybe here's a custom uploaded image that the user wants to have on their jacket. And then we generate an image and send it back. This is the most typical type of scenario. In almost all cases, these applications have been integrated with other people's business logic or other systems. They're not standalone. So there's not just a system there that makes images, that's fine, but there's also logic for example, in the configuration space, you need logic to say which options are compatible with each other. That obviously doesn't come from the rendering. So for example, you might not be able to have certain color combinations, or if it's the hood on a jacket might only be compatible with a certain kind of collar and these sorts of things. That business logic has to come from elsewhere. The other thing we have to think about is how much interactivity does a customer actually need? Some of the use cases you saw, the customers batch generate a lot of things beforehand. So they basically use our software more as an automation tool to do the batch rendering. In other cases, they're actually seeing it live. So the boathouse example you saw at the end runs on Nimbix, and the users, as they configure their sporting apparel products, are getting images back immediately as they're making configuration changes. And the kind of scale we're talking about here is on the order of seconds. So in the case of Boathouse, the images take around 4 seconds to render for their particular products. And that's whenever the user makes a configuration change. But it's important to think about how much interactivity you need and whether you can, you know, queue or batch things, because queuing and batching makes things a lot more easy to manage in terms of spreading the load around and getting resources and so forth. But if the user's at the other end waiting for it, then that's not something you're going to be able to do. We get asked a lot when people come and use our technology whether the stack matters, you know, what programming languages I'm using and these sorts of things. The reality is these days it really doesn't matter. I mean, pretty much everything can call web services, and that's how we expose our technology. So whether you're using PHP, Python, Node.js, C++, whatever it is, you can pretty much call these services. And the same goes for the Nimbix cloud services as well and pretty much everything else. So really the stack doesn't matter too much. And typically our customers are building applications where there's 5 or 6 stacks all siloed in the different pieces of business logic. So they have one stack that they're using in payment processing, one they're using in compatibility rules for configuration, and they all just talk to each other through web services. It's also important to think about whether the app itself controls provisioning. So in some cases, we do it behind the scenes. In other cases, the user actually affects the provisioning directly. And I'll show an example of that at the end, where the user is actually doing the provisioning on Nimbix. Basically, we're doing it on their behalf. So what's a typical application look like that we build? We deploy a lot of applications on Nimbix using Reality Server. Usually, they're interactive. So most of our applications are interactive in nature, and they have, you know, response times vary between seconds or minutes, but typically not hours. So people are not looking at results they're going to get back hours later. Usually minutes would be the absolute limit of the amount of time you'd want to look at. Most of the time we're talking to Reality Server using JSON RPC, which you may or may not be familiar with. It's a simple web services protocol, command-based. It's not a REST protocol, but it's very easy to use, and you basically just post stuff to the server and ask for responses back. We often use Node.js on the server side if we're building the things. If the customers are building them, then they'll be using whatever stack they have. Node.js is something that we use a lot because it's very easy to integrate with web services and with our web services in particular. But as I said, with the other applications, the business logic tends to live elsewhere. So usually we're just focused on the rendering as a black box. So we build that out and then show the customers how to connect it into their systems. And usually that means interacting with multiple web services, not just one, and maybe using different protocols as well. So on the deployment side, let's say you've got your application, you've created it. What about getting that out to the users? So, you know, a lot of the time we're building things in-house for quite a long time, but at some point you have to deploy it and you have to get it out to the actual customers and they have to be using it. There's a lot of things that need to think about during this process. I'm not going to cover them all in detail. I'm going to cover one in particular in more detail, which is capacity planning. But some other things, redundancy, for example, in HPC, you know, you don't really care if a node fails or whatever, you rerun the job or these sorts of things. We're dealing here with services where the customers have end users on the other end. So, for example, Boathouse, you know, the apparel configurator, they have customers there using the system. If it goes down, their customers can't see their products and they're not going to order products they can't see. So there are real business impacts to having problems with the service. To that end, you really have to think about redundancy. So on the front end, usually this isn't on the GPU side. Usually it's at the very front of it. So, for example, whatever you're doing for load balancing, reverse proxying, those sort of things. You also need to be thinking about how they scale. You know, when the demand comes in, are you going to be able to scale out the compute side to deal with it? Obviously, that's something that the cloud is very good at. And one of the reasons that we typically use Nimbix is because a lot of our customers will start with a small static resource, maybe one or two servers, and then they'll use dynamic for the rest. With one or two servers, at least two is ideal because then you can see when the first one is fully consumed, you can say, let's put some dynamic ones on and try to stay ahead of the curve in terms of when the users are coming in. It's also important to think about getting value for money in terms of the resources you're using. You know, are the resources you're using representing the best price performance ratio of what you can get? And there's a lot of different options, even on Nimbix, that you can choose from. And it may depend on your application as to which particular processing resources give the best value for money. In classifying your application, what I'm talking about here is deciding essentially whether you have a interactive application or a batch application. It's important to make that distinction because a lot of the considerations that we have with customers vary depending on this one parameter. If it's interactive, then the response time becomes critical. And also dealing with redundancy and those sort of things becomes more critical because there's going to be an immediate visibility of any problems. If it's a batch system, quite often a little bit of latency and so forth is not really going to be critical. So just to peel off the top and talk about capacity planning. Capacity planning is really, and I do say the art of capacity planning quite often because it's a bit of a black art. It's a very difficult problem. But it is also by far the most common question we get from customers is, how many servers do I need? Now, in the HPC world, you're probably much more used to saying, how many can I have? You know, give me 100 servers, give me 200 servers if I can have them. Our customers, typically, they want to get away with the minimum number of servers possible because every time they have to use more resources, that means obviously more cost. And it means if they're, for example, selling configurable products, what they have to think about is, how much is my cost of sale? So how much does it cost me to generate those images to the customers? And a lot of that's going to factor in if the customer buys the product, if they convert, how much money do I make from that customer? So if the product is sold for $100, for example, maybe they can afford to spend 20 cents on rendering an image if they convert 10% of the customers, those sort of things. But it's by far the most common question, how many servers do I need? The problem is they also, our customers typically ask this question with no data. So they come in and they say, how many servers do I need? But they're also, when we ask, well, how many simultaneous users do you think you'll have? Usually they don't know. So usually it's, we have to try and help them guess. And to be realistic and to actually do anything useful with capacity planning, you have to have some assumptions, which you're prepared to change, or you have to have some data. Now, capacity planning is, you know, there's probably whole courses run on this topic, and there's definitely a lot of schools of thought. There's plenty of books out there, and there's lots of good books that you can see. We've written a blog article actually too on this question, in which we provide references for several books on capacity planning, which is on our website. But there's a lot of schools of thought in this topic. It's usually critical for our customers to do this though, because we're doing software development for them, and that has a cost. The licensing has a cost. But usually this is actually the biggest component, is their use of hardware. And actually that's going to be usually most of the cost, especially since that runs forever as they're using the service. So it's actually quite critical for them to do some at least rudimentary capacity planning and work out what kind of prices they're going to have. It really is a moving target though, because their assumptions might change at any time. The number of simultaneous users could change because of some campaigns they're doing and so forth. So it's quite a difficult thing to plan for, but you have to at least make some kind of attempt. And what I'm going to describe next is a simple approach that we use, and it could be used in other areas for doing some basic capacity planning on some of these applications and estimating what the hardware requirements might be. So this is going to be, I think there's six steps here. Basically, the first thing you want to do is pick what's the base hardware configuration I'm going to test on. So that might be, let's say, a machine with one GeForce GTX Titan in it or something like that, or one M6000. Whatever it is, you should try and pick something that has a reference known performance that you can then index against other machines. So, for example, if you know, that the machine with the Titan X is four times faster than a machine with an M2090, you can use that to extrapolate different hardware scenarios without actually having to run the full tests. It's always better to run the full tests if you can, but you can do a lot of back of the envelope stuff with this pretty quickly if you do it on a very well-known hardware configuration. The next important thing to do is pick a representative data set, something that is representative of what you think is going to be typical in your application. So not too big, not too small, but pretty much the average. This can be a tricky thing to pick, but usually you can find something that you think is pretty representative. And the next bit, which is the hardest for our customers in particular, is to say what the minimum performance you need to have is, because they're always trying to work out the least number of servers. So what's the absolute minimum? And by this, what we mean is, when is it at the point where the performance is unacceptable, where you say that at the end of the day, that's not an acceptable experience for the customer? Now, you have to think about this, for example, as one of these configurator scenarios where the customer is someone at the other end waiting for an image of their configuration. And in some cases, the customer might say, well, I need that back in 5 seconds, or I might need it back in 20 or 30 seconds. Whatever that number is, you need to think about what that minimum requirement is. Now, a lot of our customers start with too high expectation in this respect and say, well, I want my image back in 1/10 of a second. And then they run the capacity planning for that, and they say, well, maybe I don't need 1/10 of a second. Maybe I'll settle for 3 or 4 seconds, at 1/100th of the cost. So it's something that it's kind of an awakening moment for the customers, because they have to think about, well, now I'm actually going to have to spend money on this. I need to work out how much I actually need. The next step, which is sometimes it's painful, but usually just because the data is not there, is working out how many maximum simultaneous users they might have. If they've got an existing website, this can be pretty straightforward. They can just look at their data and say, okay, what percentage of the users do I think will flow through to the configuration path of our website? And then say, okay, I reckon this percentage of them are going to come through and use the configurator, and this percentage will generate an image, and then they can get some kind of reasonable estimate for the maximum simultaneous users. The only critical thing here is to point out to them quite often that we're not talking about hits, which is a common metric. They might talk about, oh, we get this many uniques per month or whatever it is. We don't care about that. We only care about how many come in at the same time, because that's how many resources you're going to need. Once you've got all this, the idea is to run the tests using your representative data set on your base hardware and then determine the requirements. And when you run the tests, what you're going to do is you're going to run them for one user, two, three, four on that base hardware. And then once you get to the point where you exceed that threshold of the minimum performance, you stop, roll back one user and say, that's the maximum number of users that I can support on this server at any time. So just to give a concrete example, let's start with the assumptions that we have a base hardware is a GeForce Titan X. We've got a kitchen scene, maybe one of the ones we saw in the video before, photorealistic rendering. And let's say we want to get that in 60 seconds. That's the absolute worst performance that we want to see. And let's say we're going to have 50 users concurrently using the system. So we set all that up, we run our tests, and we say, okay, so for one user, we can render that in 10 seconds. For two users, it's taking 18 seconds, and so on. We get to seven users, and it's gone past our threshold of 60 seconds. So we say, okay, that's too many users on one server, so let's roll it back one. And we say 58 seconds, six users. So the maximum number of users we can get on a single server is six in this example. Let's say we've got 50 simultaneous users, so the math's pretty easy there, obviously. Now we need nine servers. Now this is really rudimentary. It's obviously not a rigorous approach, but it's definitely going to give you some idea for the kind of ballpark you're talking about, number of servers, and at least give our customers an idea of how much cost might be involved in deploying a real-world interactive service like this. So just talk a little bit about actually deploying on Nimbix, which we're doing quite a lot. I'm going to talk a little bit about some of the things that Nimbix offers that make this useful for us. And also I'm going to talk a little bit about Java 2.0, which you've probably obviously already seen or been using. I'm just going to talk about some things that are really relevant to us in that release. You know, what made that important for us. And there's a few things there that were probably also important for everybody else in the room. Image management was a big deal for us because we were deploying these things for customers and we had a lot of stuff floating around. And if you use the old system, you probably know the pain of messing up one of your NAEs and not being able to get it back to the state you need it in for an application. This is even more critical for these types of deployments because if we encounter a problem, for example, with our customer like Boathouse, and we've changed the system and we have to roll it back to a previous state, we basically have to reinstall it from something that we have in the past. Now we don't have that issue. We use the Nimbix API a lot, and it's now massively cleaner than it used to be. The old system had a lot of problems when you're building stuff for it. You could get it to work, but you had to do a lot of error-prone things in your own code to make it work. Now it's a lot cleaner, a lot simpler to use, and I'll talk about it in a little bit more detail later on. SSH keys are great. Don't have to mess around with passwords anymore. I mean, you can if you want, but you don't have to. Just add your key. All the machines, just simple SSH config addition, and then everything you log into, passwordless. Sudos all set up. Much, much better. I've already found this has sped up just general productivity with messing around with Nimbix nodes a lot. The launch speed's also improved a lot, and this is huge for us. So launch speed is actually one of the number one reasons we use Nimbix. So we have a lot of customers that use AWS as well, but the big problem there is you launch a node, especially a GPU node, it might take 5 minutes. It might take 30 seconds, but it might take 5 minutes. You just don't know. There's no way you can tell. And in our case, there might be someone on the other end waiting for that thing to launch and get interactive results. In most cases, our users, 5 minutes, they're gone. So they've closed whatever they're doing and given up. No, that's too long. So launch time is really critical for us. And this is the thing we've pushed Nimbix the hardest on from our side, is to say, okay, how do we get these launch times down as low as possible? Because there's someone else on the other end. The new hardware options, obviously, they're available. Great to see. And obviously the expansion of things like Titan X, which is the highest performing GPU that we've ever used, is great to see. For vendors like us who are putting our actual applications in Nimbix so that users can use them as a street grab service, there's a lot of cool stuff in there now where we can put more help text and things in, better formatted stuff where the user can get started a bit easier without having to SSH into the node and find some README file that I've stuck on there, that sort of thing. Release management with the images is also helping a lot. the staging release system. But I think one of the things that's really important for us is that Nimbix actually have listened to a lot of the stuff that we've said. So we've given quite a bit of feedback, maybe more than they want to hear, but we've given a lot of feedback on what we think of how Nimbix works. And, you know, there's a lot of other cloud providers out there, you know, I won't talk about the names, but, you know who they are, who as almost a policy won't listen to you and pretty much ignore everything you want to say. If it doesn't do it today, they're not willing to talk about it. So this is something that's been great for us to see, is that, you know, actually our feedback has been incorporated, especially in the API side of things. So on the API, the API is really critical to the types of applications that we're deploying, because we're not running processes where someone sits there and starts something off and then they wait for it to finish. This is all got to be completely automated, no human intervention. The new API is fantastic for this, the new Nimbix API. If you haven't looked at the docs, you can see there the URL where you've got all the endpoint documentation. So for us, you know, what does an API actually need to have for cloud deployments? Some really obvious stuff. You've got to be able to start and stop resources. This is pretty much the most fundamental thing you've got to be able to do. And you've got to be able to do that in an automated way. You need to know when those resources didn't start or failed to start for whatever reason. So you need some feedback on that. Once you've got a node, you need to be able to connect to it. In a lot of our cases, we're connecting from public IPs, so you need to be able to connect that way. So you need to be able to get your IP address, these sorts of things. You also need to be able to tell, like, what's in flight at the moment? What have I got running? What's going on? So you need some API to get that information back and know how many nodes you're running, maybe what they're running, that sort of thing. If you're outputting things to the console, you might need the console output from those nodes, maybe to process, look for errors in the logs, or if you're getting usage data, that sort of thing. But these are just the bare minimum. Obviously, there's a lot of nice to haves in an API, but this is enough for everything we need to do typically on a day-to-day basis. So the Java 2.0 API, as I said, it's become a lot simpler. It's really now a really simple, clean REST API. Basically, all the data is JSON. So most of the requests are simple GET requests, just with URL parameters. So you can test this just with curl or Postman, which is a good Chrome app if you haven't used it, or anything that you can make HTTP requests with. So you can just send these requests with URL parameters and off you go. There's only one request at the moment that needs a post, and that's the submit request that submits a job to make a new start a new node. And that needs quite a bit of information. So with that, you're just posting a JSON, basically just a dump of JSON, which is actually some of the things that Steve had in his presentation, was showing the sort of JSON snippets of what you start a node with a different workload and different machine and so forth. Most of the stuff you can do in the dashboard, you can do with the API, with the exception of things like the images and that sort of thing. But the starting and stopping and controlling nodes, you can pretty much do. And you get the output, get the connection, all the stuff that we need is there. A big change, which is really helped us, is that the job number and name are now pretty much interchangeable. So before, when you submit, you got back a job name, but then every other request of the API asked for a job number. So before you could actually do anything else in the API, you had to go and say, okay, I've got this job name, tell me the number for it, which is another round trip and so forth. So now everything's interchangeable. You can use the job or the name or the number, either is fine. And this makes things a lot easier and a lot less error prone as well. In terms of starting and stopping nodes now, it's almost trivial. I mean, you can just do it in a shell with curl if you want. You don't even need to write an application. Recently, I ported one of our applications from the Java 1.0 API, and it was actually really easy. It took about 4 hours of work to port this old application that was using the old API to the new one, so basically about half a day. And, you know, it wasn't terribly difficult. If you're sort of starting from scratch and building something, I would say, you know, within an hour or so, you pretty much understand it and you're getting up nodes, starting and stopping and that sort of stuff. So within a day, you would pretty much be able to deploy code in your application, dynamically start and stop nodes using the new API. So I want to talk about a case study showing some of this in practice, in a scenario that we did with a customer where we deployed a service. This is Onshape. I'm going to talk about it. It's a CAD application if you know Katia or SolidWorks, these sort of things, it's basically that, but in the browser. And they do a hybrid approach where they run some computation in the cloud, some in the browser, and so forth. I'm just going to show a really quick video, which just shows it running. This is the Onshape website, and you can just pick a 3D model. So this is the CAD model, loads up. This is all WebGL based, so this is just rendering on the client, but all the data is coming from the cloud. So everything here is on the cloud. So here we're going to pick a reality server application. And now this tab that you're going to see here, this is loaded from Nimbix. And this start server area at the top, when the user presses this button, this is firing off a Nimbix API request, which is starting up a server on Nimbix. And now it's sitting there waiting and say, okay, when the node is started, I'm going to give the user some feedback to say that the node is ready and it's up and running and they've got these GPUs and they can continue. So in this application, the user is directly provisioning resources on Nimbix through our account. So obviously this is something that we provide to the customer. So here they've got their node. It's all started up. Again, this is just straight through the API. Really easy to set up. In fact, it took longer to write the boilerplate HTML for the website than it did to actually do the API stuff. So once you're starting now, this part is being served from a GPU resource. So what you're seeing here, what you'll see shortly, is a web application running inside Onshape, and the bit inside the window there is being served from Nimbix. And if you spin around in this, you'll see that this rendering is coming from Reality Server. This was recorded actually with me using it from Australia, from servers in the US, so it's a little bit of latency there. But you'll sort of see the rendering dynamically improve in quality, you know, as you progress. So this is just an example of something that we've deployed in the cloud. So what was all that? Well, basically that was a whole lot of cloud. So you've got a full CAD system in the cloud, talking to a full rendering system in the cloud through cloud-to-cloud communication. So it's just everything is in the cloud. There's no, the only local part is the guy's browser. So someone's running a browser with WebGL, and that's it for the local side of it. In this case, actually, Onshape use AWS for their cloud, and we use Nimbix. So you've got stuff on AWS talking to stuff on Nimbix, no problem. All the resources are provisioned on demand. In our case, we're using Node.js, and we're using the Jarvis API, the new API for that. We have a redundant front end and so forth. You can check that out yourself if you want, onshape.com, if you want to have a play with it. We're in their app store. Just to really to finish up, I think I'm running a bit short on time, so I'm just going to finish up with, you know, where do we see this going, and what are the things that for us are missing from this currently? You know, what do we need to see now? It's a lot better than it's ever been in terms of the availability of GPU in the cloud. When we started doing this, there really wasn't anything interesting. You know, Amazon had this one crappy instance that they had available that you could use that clearly wasn't getting updated. And now they've released, you know, Amazon have a new instance type, but it's this grid K520 machine, which our customers, they run a benchmark on it and say, I'm not going to use that, it's too slow. So pretty much, you know, almost the only option for a lot of our customers, Nimbix, because the performance is there. So there's more GPUs than ever in the cloud, and Nimbix is providing a lot of good solutions for that, but you can never have too many GPUs from our point of view. Our customers are always wanting to know, you know, how many more can they have? Can they scale it out? I want 100 GPUs, I want 200 GPUs, whatever it might be. You can never have too much, and you can never have too much of the latest hardware. And this is the constant struggle because, of course, as users, we want the latest stuff immediately, but of course, cloud providers have a commercial imperative. They have to be able to make it work financially. So there's some competing priorities there that we have to deal with. But at the end of the day, what we want to see is obviously as much hardware as possible of the latest generation and the highest performance. Consumer-grade hardware is a big issue for us because a lot of our customers, they look at the maths, you know, the financials, and they talk about whether they deploy consumer hardware or professional hardware. And a lot of our customers are not that risk averse. They're used to rolling their own hardware or rolling their own software solutions. They're not really that worried about if a card fails every now and then. So they don't mind going with consumer hardware. And the performance is higher in a lot of cases. So a lot of our customers are interested in consumer hardware in the cloud rather than server hardware in the cloud at lower prices. This is the primary reason that they're interested in it. Lower prices with some risk of failure. There's also a lot of customers that are looking for large counts of GPUs. We have one customer in Japan. They use a cluster of 200 GPUs for one user. So that one person sitting in front of an interactive 1080p rendering of basically the quality that you've been seeing here and using that for just one user. And a lot of our other users are asking, can I get that? Now, that customer, they bought all that hardware. We have a lot of other customers. They'd like to be able to do that for an hour every month or whatever it might be. You know, they don't have to buy millions of dollars worth of hardware just to be able to do it every now and then. So, but there are a lot of customers who would want to use it on a more ad hoc basis. I said the spin-up times are critical for us. We'd like to see it even faster. So, you know, seconds, less than a second, whatever the, you know, the floor is on this, we'd like to get there, because at the end of the day, that's what makes us able to launch resources quickly. Instead of having to have static resources, we can do it dynamically, because to the user, there's no difference. If it launches in less than a second, or a second, or seconds, even 5 seconds, the user's probably not going to know. Handling failures, you know, like it or not, GPUs are a little bit more exotic than CPUs still. They do fail in some mysterious ways sometimes, and we need to see some better ways of handling this, detecting these, you know, these scenarios. And while the, you know, the cost has been driven down and down and down, again, it's another thing that we still needs to go even further. We need to see that improved. So just to recap quickly what we talked about, I tried to justify why you'd actually want to use GPUs in the cloud in the first place, how we went about building some applications, how you can successfully deploy them, bit of capacity planning and so forth, what we'd like to see in the future as well. And it's all pretty high level, so if you wanted to quiz me about anything in more detail, please feel free. I'm running a little over time, so I don't know if I have time for questions, but thank you very much.
Paul, thank you very much. Very interesting. And I just want to say that Paul will be on a panel later. We are a little tight on time. We'll take maybe one or two questions now. But if you have questions for Paul later, he'll be able to answer them. You guys can ask maybe 40 questions later. But we'll take maybe one or two now. So
you raised your hand for me.
Paul, at the beginning, you mentioned that that it took 10 minutes versus 10 or 10 seconds versus 10 minutes.
I believe that was 2 hours versus 10 minutes.
2 hours versus 10 minutes. What would bring it down to 10 seconds?
More hardware. So,
well, which part is it? It's you need more GPUs.
Yes.
You need more bandwidth into the GPU.
What? So that was a really specific example. I mean, there's a lot of things where we're already rendering things at multiple frames per second, even 10 or 15 frames per second. It depends on the scene. It depends on the quality requirements that the customer has. So even that image, we would be getting images back in less than a second. They just would be very noisy. So they would have noise in the image, and that noise disappears over time. So we have a progressive rendering system. So it's usually a little different to say in games, you talk about frame rate. You know, you talk about how many frames per second can I generate? For us, it's about how converged is each frame, you know, how noise-free is each frame going to be. So the less hardware you have, the more noise you get at the start. So the more noise in each frame. More hardware means you can get less noise in every frame. So the customer we mentioned that uses 200 GPUs, they can get on the order of 15 frames per second at 1080p with fully converged photorealism, but that's because they're using 200 GPUs on one job. So it's primarily hardware. And just more of it. So the balance is, of course, you've got how much hardware in one machine and how much hardware in multiple machines. In one machine, it's really easy to scale, and we already scale very well. On multiple machines, it becomes trickier. So that's where it's, interconnect and those sort of things becomes more important. And in our customer who's using 200 GPUs, they're actually using the NVIDIA Quadro VCA device, which uses InfiniBand for that NRDMA technology on the back end.
One more.
When you're talking about the faster startup times, are you segmenting between the reality server being started up, the NAE starting up from scratch, or is it just the rendering time?
The rendering time we pretty much ignore. I mean, it varies a lot in our application. So reality server takes about 3 or so seconds to start up. Most of that's CPU bound because it's, you know, and disk IO bound because it's basically loading stuff from disk, loading files, those sort of things, which are not really going to get much faster. So the startup time of the node is pretty much added on top of all that. We've got Reality Server down to the point where it starts quickly enough that we basically feel it's acceptable if the node startup time was zero. So it's sort of everything on top. So the node startup time, in all the numbers that I mentioned, was just the node startup time. I was ignoring Reality Server startup time. So right now we start a node on the old Nimbix system. It takes about 40 seconds to start a node on average at the moment, which is actually pretty good because it's good because it's stable at 40 seconds. It's not 30 seconds and then 5 minutes and then 3 minutes and then 40 seconds. It's always 40 seconds. So we can rely on it. So that's the big difference for us.